you for inviting me to discuss with you whether or not we are dealing with different mechanisms target cells in obstetric and thrombotic APS. I don't have any disclosures. Starting from the association between antiphospholipid and pregnancy complications, we have to accept that beta 2 glycoprotein 1 dependent antiphospholipid antibodies are the biomarkers for both obstetric and vascular APS. So apparently we are dealing with the same antibodies able to activate complement cascade, displaying comparable epitope specificity, but the big difference between the vascular environment, the placenta environment, is represented by the different antigen availability. There are additional players important in such pathogenesis. And once again, I will try to translate what the experimental model told us to the patients. So even recently, it was underlined that the association between antiphospholipid antibodies and recurrent miscarriages or fetal deaths or pregnancy complications such as preeclampsia or placental insufficiency are quite supported by the data, even though the reports are not really, and there are some debates. Although most patients with APS have both vascular and obstetric manifestation, it's also true, definitely, that there are isolated vascular or obstetric variants. So obstetric APS, pure obstetric APS, is a sort of a specific subset within the APS box. And in these patients, usually, maternal thrombosis or even progression to SLE are scarce, supporting the idea that this is a subgroup of patients with a different identity. Beta 2 glycoprotein 1 is the main target antigen, and beta 2 glycoprotein 1 dependent antiphospholipid antibodies are the main pathogenic antibodies. We presented in the previous talk that beta 2 glycoprotein 1 can be present on the surface of different cells, including endothelial cells or other cells involved in the coagulation cascade. But this is also true for cells that are key player in the placentation, such as trophoblasts and the sigma cells. We still don't know exactly the true physiological role of beta 2. We, at the beginning, thought that it was a sort of a natural anticoagulant, but it's becoming more and more popular, the idea that beta 2 glycoprotein 1 is one of the several scavenging proteins in our body. There are data from knockout animals from the Creelis group showing that likely beta 2 glycoprotein 1 could play a role in the physiological placentation. So focusing the attention on its importance in the placenta tissues. And actually, the main difference between what is going on in the vessels and what is going on in the placenta is the fact that even in physiological conditions, we have a huge amount of beta 2 glycoprotein 1 which can be detectable on the surface of the trophoblast. This is the villi, which are cross-sectioned and stained with monoclonal antibodies against the human beta 2 glycoprotein 1. You can see that there is a strong strong staining. More importantly, the beta 2 glycoprotein 1 in this location is quite in contact with the maternal, with the intervillous space and with the maternal blood. So the maternal anti-beta 2 glycoprotein 1 antibodies can be easily in contact with the beta 2 on the villi, on the placenta. We reproduce the same situation also in animals. You can see that in pregnant mice, if you injected pregnant mice with beta 2 glycoprotein 1 labeled with a fluorochrome, you don't see the beta 2 in the vascularized tissue, such as kidney, spleen, or brain. You can find a strong signal in the placenta or even in the cord. And you don't see anything in the pups. So basically, exactly what we saw in the sections, in the tissue section of human placenta. Placenta can offer beta 2 glycoprotein 1 to the maternal blood if the blood contains anti-beta 2 glycoprotein 1 antibodies. These antibodies can bind to the beta 2, and after the binding, they can inhibit trophoblast proliferation, differentiation, can induce trophoblast apoptosis, can also affect angiogenesis and spiral artery development. The main effect is on the steps that are important for the physiological placentation. And in other words, we can say that beta 2 glycoprotein 1 dependent antiphospholipid antibodies mediate pathogenic mechanism other than placental thrombosis. So the story of the APS in the placenta is a little bit different from what we are used to see in the vessels. It's true that the antibodies can also recognize the beta 2 on the decidual cells and extravillous trophoblasts, and the binding of the antibodies and the complement activation can induce a local inflammatory response. The antibodies, once bound, can activate complement system, can crosstalk with the coagulation, and actually we can find some fibrin deposition around the villi, as well as some placenta vessel thrombosis, but thrombotic events are not the main pathogenic manifestation. The antibodies can affect the trophoblast physiology in a different manner, can affect reduce, can affect proliferation and migration, can alter the vascular remodeling, can activate complement, can induce the secretion of inflammatory cytokines, and can release dangerous nuclear aggregates such as microvesicles and exosomes from the placenta tissue. So having said that, we know how the antibodies can damage the placenta tissues. So basically, we can say that the anti-beta 2 GP1 antibodies are the main pathogenic antiphospholipid antibodies that mediate both the vascular and in particular the placenta damage. But if we inject IgG APL from pure vascular or obstetric APS, we can induce fetal loss of thrombi respectively in the animals, meaning that independently on the clinical manifestation that have been associated with a given IgG preparation, the same IgG fraction can induce both clotting and fetal loss in the animals. The other big difference between the vascular APS and the pregnancy APS is the fact that the passive transfer of IgG-APL in naive pregnant animals does not need the second hit to induce fetal loss. While this is true for triggering the clots in a naive animals, this is not required in naive pregnant animals. So the question whether or not we are really dealing with the same antiphospholipid antibodies is a very hot question. Regarding the antigen specificity, we know that they are directed, both are directed against the beta-2 glycoprotein 1. So we look at whether the epitope specificity of the anti-beta-2 glycoprotein 1 antibodies could be able to distinguish between the antibodies associated with thrombosis from those associated with pregnancy morbidity. And actually, what we can say that anti-domain 1 are much more associated with late pregnancy morbidity, which is the most specific manifestation of the APS, obstetric APS, much more associated than the anti-domain 4 and 5. So mimicking more or less what we have already seen for the thrombotic, for the vascular APS. Anti-domain 1 are the most important antibodies. We tried to see whether there was any functional difference between IgG anti-beta-2 antibodies collected from pure vascular APS and those collected from pure obstetric APS. In collaboration with a group of Anisur Rahman, we tried to see whether the IgG fraction from pure obstetric APS displayed different biological effects on monocytes and trophoblast cells. And you can see that actually the even looking at the gene expression of the cells incubated with the pure obstetric or pure vascular in comparison with healthy controls, you can see that there was a different effect of these antibodies, showing that, for example, there were much more effect on, for example, genes coding for cell adhesion or embryonic organ morphogenesis in the IgG from pure obstetric patient than from vascular patients. But anyway, such a tool to discriminate between obstetric and vascular pathogenic IgG is not useful in the real life. So we still need to find biomarkers specifically predictive of obstetric manifestation. We don't have real effective biomarkers able to predict whether or not a given positivity for antiphospholipid antibodies would be associated with thrombosis or with pregnancy morbidity or both. Complement, as I mentioned you before, is another new entry even in pregnancy. These are biopsies from the maternal and the fetal phase of the placenta, collected prospectively from 20 pregnancies in women positive for antiphospholipid antibodies. These are a representative example of the deposition of complement for C1, indicating that both the classical pathway can be activated and that the activation can end into the formation of the terminal C5B9. This finding fits very well with two studies previously more or less published at the same time, showing that complement activation predicts adverse pregnancy outcome in patients with SLE with or without antiphospholipid antibodies, and a more recent study, a retrospective study, showing that low preconception complement levels are associated with adverse pregnancy outcome in a multi-center study of a huge number of pregnancies in women with antiphospholipid syndrome or just simple carriers of antiphospholipid antibody. So the activation of complement by antiphospholipid antibodies can play an important role in the defective placentations responsible for the oocytic manifestation. We don't know exactly how much the complement is activated. For example, we found some complement deposition even in placentas from women who have had live births. And such a finding is difficult to be interpreted in a correct manner. For example, maybe that the complement activation may depend on its extent and on its distribution. If the complement deposits are not distributed in a huge, in a large area, so maybe they are not able to mediate any damage, or when they are limited just to restricted placental areas, maybe they cause tissue alteration that can affect the regular progression of pregnancy only marginally. So the possibility to measure, to detect how the complement activation is triggered and how the antibodies can be able to activate complement, maybe in the future can offer us the possibility to get some predictive biomarkers. For example, we have preliminary data showing that the measurement of the C5, the soluble C5b9, collected prospectively in pregnancies of patients with antiphospholipid antibodies, showed a huge increase of such complement activation products in the first part of the pregnancy, in comparison with the value that we saw in controlled pregnancies of patients with systemic autoimmune diseases, but without antiphospholipid antibodies. So in other words, maybe also the speed or the kinetics of the complement activation can be predictive for a negative pregnancy outcome, but this is just a preliminary finding that should be confirmed, increasing the number of the pregnancy. So finally, I would like just to underline once again the difference between the tissue distribution of beta-2 glycoprotein 1 in the human placenta in comparison to what we can see in the normal vascularized human tissue. It's a huge difference. So the increased presence of placenta beta-2 glycoprotein 1 can also explain why women with low titer antiphospholipid antibodies, low titer beta-2 GP1 dependent antiphospholipid antibodies, usually detectable with a persistent double positivity in the standard laboratory assay, these low titer positive women are at risk for miscarriages, at variance of the fact that low titer antiphospholipid antibodies are usually not predictive for thrombotic recurrences in the vascular APS. And more importantly, all these low titer antiphospholipid antibodies presented a very good response to the standard treatment with low-dose aspirin and low molecular weight heparin. So maybe the huge amount of the antigen can explain why even low amount of the antibodies can be enough to mediate the biological effect. And so maybe this could explain why it's time to reconsider the current classification criteria and treatment for ascetic APS, including also low titer positive women. I would like to thank once again all the people that helped us in collecting the data, and I would like to thank you for your attention.